Awesome. Thanks, Carter, for that fantastic intro. You're quite the hype man. My name is Anish. I'm a product manager at NVIDIA. Previously was, quite a number of GPU startups, but now currently work on our developer tooling. And recently I've been thinking a lot about agentic workflows, which is why I'm here today. So, today I really want to talk about KISS, agents and productions, which basically just means keep it stupid simple. And I say this because oftentimes, agents have been super cool demos over the past year. Many of them have gone to the POC stage, but often getting to production is a last hurdle, and getting there really requires a strong focus on performance and simplicity. And that's what I'm here to really help drive and explain today. So Jensen, very proudly at CES earlier this month, announced that we are now in the age of agentic AI. So, obviously started off with the 2012 moment of AlexNet, which is revolutionized deep learning. We went on to perception AI and then Gen AI with the advent of generative AI and transformers in 2018. We're now broadly in the age of agentic AI. If you haven't already picked up from all the other talks happening on today, this is the new frontier of where the world is heading, right? And this is how we're broadly thinking about it at NVIDIA too. We've had many, many use cases for how we optimize and use agents internally within the company, across from just coding assistants, helping us design our GPUs, even as like marketing assistants to help us, put out blogs and put out PR statements. But the biggest hurdle for us has been taking a lot of these, agentic POCs, taking them past day one into production where they can actually work. And we've got this larger initiative called NVIDIA Blueprints. As you can see here, we publish our reference architectures for how we build coding assistants, customer service assistants, patient care, et cetera, et cetera. And these are a result of a number of experiments that we run internally and taking them into production for some of the partners and customers that we work with. And today I'm here to describe how we kind of think about it internally. So obviously, an agent, you guys all know what it is. But I'll briefly just go through a quick one-on-one real quick just to make sure I set a baseline for how I'm thinking about these things. An agent is very much defined by the environment that it can operate in, right? And so oftentimes a user task or the input really defines the actual environment that an agent operates in. So take, for example, maybe an agent that operates in Minecraft. Because it operates in the Minecraft world, the number of tools or the action that it takes will be restricted and confined to this environment, right? And you can think of everything within this performance system. Now, if you want this agent operating at scale, though, you kind of have to start dealing with some of these performance and scalability problems. And that's where NVIDIA has a lot of time thinking about it, right? A lot of these agents right now run on APIs, run on single VMs, run in various limited use cases. But in the future, as Jensen likes to put it, we'll have digital workers, even billions of them, operating at scale. And how are these agents going to run, across, our systems and infrastructure that we currently have today? And marrying the two, how can we think about that as we develop agents moving forward? And the way I like to think about it is agents in production running at scale should do three main things. And this is how my mental model has kind of formed around keeping it stupid simple. First is, are the agents you have in production validatable? Can it do what you want? Secondly, is it steerable? Can you look underneath the hood, see what's going on, and adjust and tinker on the fly? And finally, is it consumable? Is it performance and usable at scale? In the advent of we have billions of agents and workers at scale, can it actually do that? So this kind of comes down to the three main things I'm going to be covering in this lightning talk as a high level is the tools that you want to give the agent so it can reliably do what you want, optimizing the planning in a deterministic manner so you can actually look underneath the hood to understand and adjust, and finally have a really strong eval and observability harness so you actually understand, is it performant and is it actually doing the tasks that I want to at scale? So within tools, I like to think of it as almost read-write permissioning, and not to anthropomorphize like what agents are, but you can almost, give them read-write permission the same way I give to my colleague on AWS. So very simply, I try to make my agents with as many read capabilities and not as many write capabilities, right? Because you don't want the intern or even the product manager, right, going to the code base and making production changes and having all break. And the same thing can happen with agents. Let's take, for example, an agent with, let's say, a 95% accuracy rate. With about 10 steps in a workflow, that's already down to about 60% accuracy. And let's say a workflow takes about 100 steps. That's 0.6% accuracy, right? And if you're giving these agents the ability to write and have the ability to, make these large scale decisions like updating databases, sending emails, et cetera, you really, really need to make sure your system's performant. And ideally, that's not really going to be operating at scale at the current moment. And that's why I try to focus on optimizing for tools that give agents read capabilities. And so I focus on two main things here. The first is around providing an agent with context, whether it's RAG, memory, or giving it search APIs. This has commonly been used for just giving the agent as much information as it might need. And secondly, is also extending capabilities. A lot of the foundation models out there don't necessarily have all the capabilities out of the box, and that's completely okay. Let's say, you know, you've used ChatGPT in the past. When you try to ask it simple calculator questions, it oftentimes fails. And rather than trying to retrain the model, you can actually give it a calculator tool that'll help it do these calculations. And so I think extending capabilities and adding context to an agent actually helps it operate much more. And restricting it from without having to go into the right access side of tools actually has helped us take a lot of our agents to production. So a couple of high-level tips. Don't focus on write, focus on read, and work your way up until you have to. Focus on individual tools and make sure every single tool you're using works as intended. And finally, if you detect missing tool failures, try to optimize for the workflow at scale, right? And so oftentimes when I'm looking at an agentic system, I try to compare that to a human system and see what a human might use in those tools and move it back, because that usually solves a lot of my tool failures as well, especially at scale. The second kind of paradigm I really want to think about is planning. And planning is really, really powerful because at the base of every single agentic system, you have a base model. This base model basically sets the plan for how you want the system to act, what tools you're going to execute, what steps you're going to take, how long you're going to take, et cetera, et cetera. And that's why the planning agent is extremely, extremely important. But this is also where I see a lot of workflows go wrong at scale. If you can nail planning and get it running, you're about 80 to 90% of the way in getting your agent into production. And we truly believe this at NVIDIA, and that's why we're really all in on planning agents. Specifically within planning agents, right? You can think of these sort of workflows as ones where you have the base model that kind of thinks through. Usually it's in a probabilistic manner, but you try to add some sort of guardrails on it to make it as deterministic as possible. So Anthropic has a number of great, techniques on how they go about doing this, whether it's just simple prompt chaining, whether it's LLM routing, et cetera, et cetera. But these help steer the planning phase as much as possible so that you can get to the 80 to 90% of the way there and not have to, go back to the compounding effect where an agent might be disaccurate over time. So a couple of high-level tips here as well. Usually when I focus on task execution, right, the planner has to kind of come and figure out the steps to take. And it's really, really important that you use some sort of eval mechanism or set some sort of deterministic workflow around this sort of phase. Secondly is oftentimes a planner agent within an agentic system can come up with the steps, come up with the plan to take, but it's wildly inefficient, right? And in the future, when we have billions of digital workers, we're already thinking now, how can you make sure that these agents, systems, and workflows are really efficient over time and are cheap and not really draining on resources? And finally, the last thing is, as you're working with agentic systems, it's really useful or really oftentimes that you'll see yourself drawing on metrics, drawing on evaluations, et cetera, but it's really important to gut check yourself, right? If the agent says, hey, I'm gonna go across 100 web pages and search all at once, as a human, you'd wanna judge that and be like, is that really efficient? But then you also have to remember that an agent can actually, for example, use an async function and run all 100 website queries at once, right? So it's very often that you really need to gut check yourself. Don't just rely on just pure evaluation, but also at the same time, understand agentic systems operate differently than humans. Something I really want to highlight here is the advent of like test time compute and the models that leverage that are really, really useful for planning. So I've had about 10 friends call me in the last few days asking about R1. I think R1 and these sort of reasoning models will really, really make planning much more powerful in these agentic systems. And I'm really excited to see the future of that moving forward. The final thing I do want to cover is around evals and observability, because you can build an agentic system with really strong planning, really strong tools, but as you're kind of developing off the POC level, you really need a quick way to quickly gauge how you're doing. And once you move into production, you really need a scalable system to judge these applications and iterate on the fly. And you can see this with software applications, right? As you're sort of like building stuff, you set console.logs or you set different unit tests to make sure your application as you're building it is working. And at scale, you'll have like temporal workflows or you have Datadog tracing to make sure these applications are working. And you can apply these same sort of fundamental characteristics to agentic systems as you're building them out. And we really believe this is the path to moving forward. So with early development, I tend to focus on just implementing easy OTL tracing right off the bat. Manual spans help track requests while I'm going through a workflow, and it helps with debugging super, super quickly so I can get back and understand where a workflow might be going wrong. Like I said, when an agent compounds mistakes over time, it's very quickly that it can go down a rabbit hole, and this sort of quick OTL tracing really helps me out. I like to use tools like Phoenix, Langfuse, et cetera, et cetera. These are not, you know, endorsements, but they're rather recommendations because they help track events in a centralized manner and they're really easy to get off the shelf. But as we kind of go into production, right, that's really the hard part. And that's where more granular tracing really, really changes the game. Tracking decision-making, logs, metrics, control flows around accuracy. That's extremely, extremely important for making sure you're steering the model in the right way. And also the users that are using your agent in production can actually use it in the right way and you're collecting all these logs. Because the more data you have, the more information you have on actually how you can steer your agent in the long term running at scale. Finally, having your own eval harness is extremely important. There's so many different accuracy benchmarks, so many different Sweebench, Ragbench, et cetera, that you can get off the shelf. But I think it's really important that you have your own personal eval harness as well. So constantly check the system over time. As I kind of mentioned, gut checking is one of the best ways to do it, but applying your own gut checks to some sort of quantitative eval harness is really, really useful for figuring out, okay, in the context of this environment that the agentic system needs to operate in, I can actually dictate it. So going back to kind of the high level coverage as well, like I said, the way we're thinking about agents at NVIDIA is around three main things, right? Is it validatable, right? Is it using the right tools? Is the planning phase steerable? Is it working at scale? Can I go in and tinker if needed? And finally, how consumable and how performant is it at scale? And this is where evals and observability really come into play. At NVIDIA, we don't necessarily have a set platform where you can go build agents, but we have tons of resources on how you can do it. And like I mentioned, NVIDIA is constantly putting out blueprints and reference architectures for how we're building our own internal agentic use case in production. So we have a website called build.nvidia.com where you can actually explore some of our different off-the-shelf models, right? Like I said, NVIDIA is constantly thinking about how these agentic systems can be working at scale. And we work a lot on the infrastructure underneath to support that. So think GPU layer, think CUDA, think the inference SDKs, think the models. We try to optimize all of that so you as an end developer can just focus on building agentic systems off of that and can be performant out of the box. So on build.nvidia.com, you can explore a variety of our open source models, Llama 3.370B, Llama 3.1 Nemotron 70B Instruct, but we also have a ton of the reference architecture blueprints that I mentioned to you before. So you can kind of use these guiding examples to understand how you can leverage these APIs or models out of the box and start building highly performant systems at scale. And so some example I'd like to show you today is how you can actually build an AI virtual assistant. And so this has been adopted by a variety of consulting partners and enterprise partners who have been using us. And let's walk through how this kind of quickly works. It uses RAG to understand a manual data set around purchase history and uses a variety of microservices to understand, let's say, for example, the return status of my GeForce RTX 4070 Super. It's drawing upon the sort of basic RAG tool that we've implemented in this pipeline, and it's generating a quick response using the base underlying LLM, which is Llama 3.370B. And like it says, the return status for NVIDIA GeForce is pending approval. Now, this is a cool UI demo, but if I actually want to run this, how do I actually do that? Well, we have a button here that says deploy launchable, and launchable is essentially a pre-configured environment for you to go out and just build out these systems and applications. So we built a launchable for the AI virtual assistant for customer service. You can think of it kind of like Colab, where you can get access to the underlying VM. In here, we kind of walk through how you can set up the different microservices that set up this pipeline. You can get underneath the hood, right? As I mentioned, it's really important to understand what goes into the planning phase, how everything is working, how you can steer it. And this Jupyter Notebook guide is really, really powerful for showing you, if you're technical, how you can actually tinker and move these things around and get them to work at scale. And so this is really exciting for me because we've actually not just had developers use this, we've had whole enterprises, systems, Fortune 500s who've used this virtual assistant and actually been able to implement this in customer service. Just the other day, I heard about the Bank of Thailand actually implementing this as well for some of their sovereign AI needs. So this is really, really exciting. NVIDIA's focused on highly performant production systems out of the box. And the core principles of what we're focusing on is keeping it stupid simple and working our way up so that we can have digital workers at scale. But yeah, thank you so much for your time. Please feel free to ask questions in the Discord, and please visit build.nvidia.com for all of these resources. Thank you.